Lighthouse Church presents the following message by Pastor Jason Holloman.
If you will, turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. The Adventist season is significant. Remember, the Christian calendar for thousands of years has had two pillars in the Christian calendar. And it really has been this way from the beginning. The two pillars of the Christian calendar, they are the Adventist season and the Lenten season. So that is the season entering into the giving of Jesus Christ, right? Sent to us from God, critical. So that's the season leading into Christmas. We call it the Christmas season, right? We make it about a lot of things. But it's the Advent season, the coming season. And then the second pillar is the Lenten season. It's a season of Lent entering into the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Easter season. We call it the Easter season or springtime or whatever you want to call it. But those are the two pillars of the Christian church. They are the most sacred days. There's a reason why everybody gets together and we don't miss certain times. There's a reason why we don't miss the end of Advent, which typically is a candlelight service at the end of the year on Christmas Eve. Why do we not miss that? Because it's foundational and always has been. Why do we not miss Easter? Well, because it's foundational. It always has been. It always will be. As long as Christians are on the earth, there will be believers, regardless of the nation that they find themselves in. There will be believers who celebrate those two things. Wherever you will find Christians until Jesus returns. I don't even know if I'm not making a political statement, but I mean, nations will rise and nations will fall. Better way to say that. But the believers that remain will be celebrating on these days and celebrating with the receiving of the Lord's Supper. It just is the way that it is. So why do we make a big deal of coming in? We don't want to just say, hey, Merry Christmas, and hey, we got a Christmas Eve service with candles. No, we want to enter into that season. We want to prepare our hearts for that season. Why do we care about the Lenten season, right? Is it that we want to just scourge ourselves, right, like a bunch of Catholics? I'm not bagging on Catholics. I'm really not at all. No, it's not for that. That's not why we do that. It's a season of preparation. We're preparing ourselves for this beautiful gift that is the life, death, ministry, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So today, in our Advent season, it's on the subject of hope. So we have hope, faith, love. No, I'm sorry, hope, joy, love, and peace. That's the way that we frame Advent. And it's been framed that way for many, many years. And today it's on hope. And it's interesting to me because I don't know if you guys are watching TV. We don't watch a whole lot of TV at the house. Occasionally we'll do some stuff as far as like, I don't know what you call it, like Netflix or something, Disney Plus or something like that. I don't know. But there's always advertisements right now for this movie called Wish. And it's been wearing me out. It's been wearing me out. Let me tell you why it's been wearing me out. Because it's this concept of chance. And it's this concept of like luck. It's this concept of if you wish upon a star, right? This idea, it's like, what does that even mean? So I start looking up the definitions of these things, and it's been wearing me out for weeks as I've been preparing for this idea of hope. Because you hear about hope all the time. People say hope all the time. Like, do the Cowboys play today, Jeff? They do? Okay. Oh, they play Thursday. I'm sorry. Okay. Well, if they were to play today, I would say, I hope they win. Hope. Like, there's a lot of hope there. Like, what team is playing today? See, guys, I need more help here. Somebody give me some help sports related. What did you say? Okay, oh, Jeff only cares about the Cowboys. Fine. Okay, good. Got it. The 49ers are playing today. Well, guess what? I hope they win. What does that mean? Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, my God. you know what's so funny? I know so little about sports, I don't even know that's a big deal. That is so funny. I somehow stepped in the biggest mess, and I'm going to get accosted, and it has nothing to do with the Bible. Man, I should start talking about things that I really care about in the scriptures and see if I get the same reaction. This is awesome. Yeah, guys, I have no idea. So how about this? I'm going to stand away from sports and go back to the scriptures where I'm safer. We use hope all the time. Even now. Hope is a big deal, apparently, right? And here's the problem. All of the things that we hope for, all the things that we hope will happen or will not happen, usually they are not hope in a person. It's not typically the way that it is. And what we will see here in our passage today, that it is squarely a living hope because we have a living Jesus because he lives today. And that's what we have today. 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 3. Our passage for today, verses 3 through 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Church, this is our passage. Let's pray together. This is what we ask for, Father, is that you would do what only you can do. So we're not asking for things that we can kind of do. I'm not asking for you to give me the strength to make lunch today. I think I got it. No, we're asking, oh God, for you to do things that we cannot do. We cannot change a hard heart that is in this room right now to a softer heart, a heart that's desiring of forgiveness. We cannot muster up enough grit to be saved. We need you, oh God, to save us. We cannot take brokenness and put it all together for it to be whole again. You, God, do that. And so we ask that you would do this work by the power of the name of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Spirit, that you would do this work, that this passage would leap off the page for us. It's written to them, for us. So would you help us, we pray, and ask. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, first observation of this passage is if you look at all the things that he does in this passage. In fact, if you just look through it, he causes us to be born again through the resurrection. So he kind of gives us the means by which to an inheritance. He gathers an inheritance and he keeps the inheritance. He keeps it. And then by God's power, he guards us through all of this stuff. And then he reveals it. He does all of this work. Like when I read this, it's like, my goodness, what does he not do? He's doing it all. Okay, so let me give you an illustration here. So if I'm taking my kids on a road trip, they have a part in that, right? So we like to go on long road trips. We like to drive far distances. We like to load the rig down super heavy. And I'm talking like, you know, 6 bicycles, a couple of kayaks, camper. Like we just like doing it, right? And we like to go far. So far that, you know, you got to get an oil change on the way kind of far. That's the kind of far we like to drive, right? And there's been a couple of trips where we had to get 2 oil changes, right? That's a pretty long trip. And so I'm into that. And so my kids are a part of that. But here's the thing. They're absolutely not a part of it too. Like I don't go to them and say, hey, listen, this trip's gonna be kind of expensive and I want you to start putting some money back. They would look at me and be like, I don't have anything. Like if I was to say, hey, we're gonna take a trip. We're gonna do the Northeast. It's gonna be great. We're gonna take these roads. Hey, what do you think? And they're gonna say, yeah, I have nothing. So they are a part of this. They are. Like if I was to say, hey, listen, we're going to go on a long trip. We're going to go into some pretty sketch environments. Your dad's going to load some pistols, maybe a shotgun, yada, yada, yada. They're going to say, I don't want to protect our family. They're going to be like, we don't have the capacity to do that. And guess what? They don't. So when we talk about a long trip, I pay for it. I set the environment. Right? Like they're not thinking about airing the tires. They're not thinking about the direction we're going. They have no resources in this. They have a major part in this. But all the things that make a trip happen, those are things that I'm doing. All the problems that we will have in the future, of which there always are problems, by the way, when you take a long trip like that, just assume them. I mean, the number of times that I've been in transmission shops are many, right? The number of times that I've had to do certain things on the side of the road are many. The number of times I've told my wife, start the car right when I hit the starter with a hammer, are 2. in the same trip. But the good news is, if it starts, whatever you do, don't turn it off, right? Until you forget, and then you have to hit it a second time, right? That's a true story. All of these things, all of them, all of these things, I'm handling. Why? Because I love them. I think about it. I care about them. And think about our Heavenly Father, who is in heaven, who is perfect, and our lives being, if you will, the trip. He does it all. Look at it. He causes us to be born again. He creates through the resurrection the environment. He has an inheritance. He keeps it and holds on to it. By his power, he guards us through the faith towards our salvation. The whole time. You might say, yeah, but man, listen, what if I lose my job? He's already thought about that for you. Yeah, but what if, like, you know, we have a flat tire? You don't think that God has known how to care for his people throughout their lives? He's been doing it for thousands of years. It's what he does. It's literally all he knows, is to protect and care for and consider and to know perfectly and in the greatest form of depth his people. If I know how to do that for my kids on a road trip, my wife right now, literally, you could give four backpacks, open backpacks right now, and we could go on a month-long trip. My wife will know exactly what every single kid needs 1,000 miles into that trip. She'll literally, so, oh, they look like this candy, and when they're griping, they really want this, and we'll put that in there, and oh, there's this book, and we're going to stick that in there. And I mean, even on the way home, my wife's thinking, you know what would be great, but only three of the kids like this, but two do this. And like, all I do is get four backpacks and just hand cash, and it just magically appears. It's amazing. It's like, it makes me the father of the year without any effort at all. And if my wife can do that, and if me as a good father can do that, what about a perfect God who is in heaven, who sees perfectly for his children? He will not fail. Even better than that, he will not fail you. He can't. He can't. That's only my first point. That's not even the sermon. See all that he does. Look at all the protection, all the framing that he does. Here's a second observation of this passage, as I'm just looking at the passage. First, hope. We talk about hope. We talk about these things we hope for, things we hope not to happen, apparently, and things that we want to happen. Notice here in verse 3, it is a living hope. It's a living hope. Listen, I've seen some amazing memorials. I've been to D.C. multiple times. I mean, I've been to all the greats. I've seen them. I've seen the memorials. I mean, you can stand before them and be like, this is so impressive. But I don't look at that and say, I hope, no, these guys are all dead. And all they did was pass, and it was great. A lot of it still remains. Awesome. That's great. We don't have a former hope. We don't have a former glory. The Christian has living today hope. Why? Why is it? Because our Savior lives. That's why. It's one thing to say, oh, he was a great prophet. He was super great. It's like, are you kidding me? Like, great prophets, great teachers. Like, I love Spurgeon. I talk about it all the time. I'm going to quote him in about 7 minutes. Like, shocker, right? He's a great teacher. He is not God. He is not today living like today Jesus Christ is living. Yes, Spurgeon's in heaven. I do believe he's in heaven. Now, this idea of living hope. If you have a Bible, you can turn to 1 John, 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3 says this, and I'll start here right at the beginning of chapter 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet been appeared. But we will know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who, wait for it, then hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. What does it mean to be made pure? What does it mean? Like, what does it mean to hope in something and that to purify? To hope in the singular best thing is to keep you from all stained distraction things of the age. Like to say, I hope in Christ is to have what is unfading and will never leave you. We can see this through the resurrection. Now, this inheritance is fun. So I don't know about you guys, but one of the ways that I, to get all the stuff that you have to get for a trip like we take, you have to kind of buy a bunch of stuff. And some stuff you don't need all year. Like this last trip, we needed a rooftop tent. I can assure you, I do not have the garage space to keep a rooftop tent. If those of you who know my neighborhood, then you'll know that like some garages are great. None of us have any space at all. In fact, I think the entire square footage of a rooftop tent is about how much yard I have in my backyard. Okay, very small. Which is why I use a weed eater for my backyard, right? You get it. And so I like to just buy stuff, use it, and sell it for almost as much. Gently used, I call it, right? And so I'm taking this rooftop tent to this fella, and I'm going, and I get there, and this awesome, old, cool dude comes out. And this thing weighs about 270 pounds, and it's on top of my car. And I said, hey, who's going to help us? And he said, I'm gonna do it. I said, respectfully, I'm not sure that this is going to happen. And he said, I got it. And sure enough, he and I were able to get this tent off. But it was an exhausting moment. And he invites me in. And I said, hey, man, this is a great house. He said, it's my inheritance. I said, well, tell me about that. And he said, this house is my inheritance. My parents lived here. My grandparents purchased it. And I said, well, that's really cool. I said, are you going to give it to your son? He said, it's in my son's name already. I said, you're kidding me. 4 generations in one house. And he said, yes. I was like, that's amazing. I was like, do you have any other inheritance-related things that you're going to give to your son? And he said, no, because this house will remain forever in my family. And my heart broke for him. And I said, ah, man, it's not. I didn't say it out loud. I wouldn't disrespect him. But I walked away initially encouraged. So I thought, oh, cool, you know, 4 generations, that's great. Man, can you encourage my dad to consider the same kind of giving? That would be really great. I was like, hey, what's your number? I'm gonna introduce you to somebody for a new best friend. How about that? You know, a little too late for that, but you get the idea. You get the idea. But I walked away so sad, and it caught me because as I was walking out, the soffit of the house, as I exited the house, you know how when you're coming in, you have the soffits and fascias, and as I was walking out, it occurred to me, this guy needs this thing to hold on to and to be his legacy, his inheritance. And as I was walking out, I could just see paint chipping and chips in the brick. And then as I began to walk down the sidewalk, it became more clear. Oh man, the roots are tearing up the sidewalk. And all the things that I didn't notice going in, I noticed going out. Why? Because the house to him, when I walked in, it was just this dude's house. But when I was walking out, it was something far more precious to him, and I could see its errors. And what does the scripture say? To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, unfading. Guys, the number of pillows that I have to put outside on our outside chairs every year because of fading alone is unbelievable. I can't even keep throw pillows at their original splendor. And we assume so much here about the way that we can hoard our treasure. And what does this say? We have an inheritance. Friend, if you're a Christian, we have an inheritance, imperishable, undefiled. It does not fade, and it's kept. Now listen, who keeps your treasure is important, by the way. This is critical. It's critical. I mean, can you imagine if I was like, hey, listen, all of my life's work, everything that I have that I've worked for, I'm just gonna, you know, just kind of just keep it right here. It'll be fine. No, who keeps your treasure is important. We drove to Kentucky a few years ago. We drove past Fort Knox. I was telling my kids, they're like, why are we going here? This is so dumb. It's like, no, this is a super cool place. It's like, Fort Knox? Like, why? It's like, this is where the nation's treasure is. This is here. It's at Fort Knox. I'm like, but what do we keep there? Is that where all the dollars are? I was like, no, I really hope there's a lot of gold there for those dollars. But no, this is where the nation keeps its treasure. Well, why is it so fortified? Because the way that we keep our treasure is critical. And for the Christian, yours is kept in heaven by the Father. You think a safety deposit box is safe? You think a safe is safe? You think Fort Knox is safe? In fact, it's literally an epitaph to something being safe. It's like Fort Knox, right? By God's power are being guarded. A third observation of this text is this. The resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. It says here that this hope that we have is through it. Now, this is kind of important. Seriously, follow me for a little bit. It's through the resurrection. Why does that matter? We've talked about this. The resurrection is the hinge in history. I would make the case that it's not even the cross. Why? I made this case a few weeks ago. Because there was a lot of dudes that died on Roman execution devices. Being crucified wasn't necessarily the thing. In fact, you hear a lot of folks say, I don't want to wear a cross. It's a crucifixion device, you know, it's a Roman method of torture. I don't want to wear that, right? You kind of hear those arguments occasionally. But listen, seriously, the cross is unbelievable because God sent his son to die upon that cross. But the hinge is the resurrection. There were tons of messiahs that came through. Some were even crucified. There was lots of dudes, even some named Jesus. We have other Jesus in the Bible. We just call them something different to not confuse the proper nouns. But yes, there was tons of those things. None of them were resurrected. None of them ever will be. The resurrection is the hinge. So why is that our hope? Why is that our hope? Because Jesus, through all of his suffering, all of his difficulty, all the things he experienced in his life, beat death. Beat it. The resurrection is proof that God will not fail you. Friend, he will not fail you. God cannot fail you. He did not fail Jesus. Why? Because he was resurrected by the power of the Spirit, by the providence of the Father. Now, there's this idea here, and turn with me if you can to 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 15, and I'll read this. It's just amazing. Verse 19, for if in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people to be pitied most. Paul's making an argument here. He's saying if there's no resurrection, there's no this. If Jesus wasn't resurrected, then that means that all those that went before him are dead and there's no hope. And what is he saying here? This is critical. If we're only hoping in Christ in this age, this is very, very interesting language. You would kind of think this. You'd kind of think, no, what Paul's saying is, no, he's just saying that you can hope in Christ and, you know, but you have to make a big deal of the resurrection. That's not what he's saying. Paul is saying, if you only find your hope in this age in Christ, we are to be pitied. Why? Because the whole point of the hope in Christ is the age to come. That's the entire point. That is why hope is in a person. And that is why hope is through resurrection, not the cross. Though the cross is unbelievable. We celebrate the cross every day. Or every Sunday, we celebrate through the broken body and shed blood. But hope is found through the resurrection. Now, I need to apply this to specific things. Why? Because there are times where the Bible feels so cheap. There are times where just saying, hey, hope, hey, have some hope, feels so cheap. And I know it does. In fact, if you don't believe that, the Bible knows that there are times where this feels cheap. You can turn to Psalm 77. Psalm 77 will demonstrate to you that there is a sadness, there is a difficulty, there is a lament that feels like even when focusing on God and His Word feels so cheap. And I'm here to tell you, even if it does, it is the most valuable and precious thing there is. It's true. This week, just this week, I mean, we've got folks that went to the hospital last night because their child had a seizure. This week, we have folks with hard medical things that are most difficult late in the afternoon. We've got folks that are unbelievably fearful that they're going to lose pregnancies. We've got folks in here right now that are so badly and desperately trying to get pregnant. We've got folks in here whose marriages are just unbelievably struggling. We've got folks in here who are still grieving over the loss of their spouse. We've got folks in here right now who are just unbelievably overwhelmed because of this and this and this and this right now. And these are just things that I know about. These are the things that I know about. I mean, there are so many things that we need hope in. So many things. And sometimes when you just say, hey, man, the Bible says to be hopeful, just feels cheap. I know it does. And even if it feels that way, there is nothing more precious or valuable. Now, Spurgeon says this. Told you. Spurgeon says this. Oh, what a blessing hope like this is, that though we fall asleep, we shall surely wake again. And when we awake, we will be in the likeness of the great head of the family, King Jesus. And we ourselves shall be heirs of an inheritance that will be there and will be kept there for us, where there will be no sin or corruption. That inheritance that is kept for us and will be kept in such a way that we can be doubly sure. It's His, it's kept by Him. Happy are the people to whom these verses of 1 Peter apply, Christian. That is you. Happy should we be. And yet, some of us are longing to look for hope. So Chuck Swindoll, in his book, Hope Again, fantastic book, by the way, in his book, Hope Again, and if you don't want to read it, that's fine. I'm literally going to give you 12 summational points from his book. But this is important. This is important for you. Because this is our application, and this will apply to some of you, one of you in the room. And that's the whole point of this, is to say that we are to hope. What do we hope for? We're between the two Advents. We have the sending of the Son, and we wait for the return of Jesus. And until then, we're a people waiting. This is what he says. This is one of the points. When we are trapped in a tunnel of misery, hope points us to the light at the end of the tunnel. There are members of our church who are feeling unbelievably trapped. When we are overworked and exhausted, hope gives us fresh energy. When we are discouraged, hope lifts our spirits. When we are tempted to quit, hope keeps nudging us on to keep going. When we lose our way in confusion or blurred destinations, hope dulls the edge of our panic. When we struggle with crippling disease and lingering illnesses, hope helps us persevere beyond the pain. There are at least three members of the church right here in this room who do not have pain that stops. When we fear the worst, hope brings reminders that God will be in control. When we must endure the consequences of bad decision, hope fuels our recovery. When we find ourselves unemployed, hope tells us that we still have a future. There are at least four people in this room right now who are no longer getting contracts or expecting to be laid off and are looking for employment. Hope is for the unemployed. When we are forced to sit back and wait, hope gives us patient trust. When we feel rejected and abandoned, hope reminds us that we are not alone, that we'll make it. When we say our final farewell to someone we love, hope in this life, hope will get us through the grief of that difficult goodbye. Put simply, when life hurts and dreams fade, nothing helps like hope. Why? Because we have a living hope. Jesus Christ is our living hope. For those that today will suffer unbelievable pain, and that will happen today for people in our congregation, hope in Jesus, it ends when he returns or you see him. Trust that we have a living hope. For those in the congregation that are looking for a job, there are people that will leave this service and they will go to their houses, they will type on the computer looking for a job. Oh God in heaven, would you bring them work? Don't lose hope. We trust in Jesus. He is a living hope. For those in here right now who cannot stand their spouses, don't raise your hand. Don't you do it. It only gets super awkward, I promise. I promise. But there's some folks in here that are just eye-rolling their spouse. Oh, Lord, how long am I going to be with this person? There's some tough marriages in the room. Hear me. Hear me. Don't lose hope. Hope in Christ. He will not fail you. That's what we hope in. He won't fail. And there's 1,000 other things in the room. There's 1,000 other things in this age. There's 1,000 ways to be fearful. There's 1,000 things to wish upon a star for. It's for pagans. It's for pagans. Christians believe in the providential work of God. Friend, and even when it's hard to see, even when it's hard to believe, be honest about it. Be honest about it. And so some of you probably need to jump up here in the prayer team and say, man, I want to hope, but I don't believe any of that. And I want to believe it, but I don't believe it. And you know what we're going to do? We're not going to freak out. Oh my gosh, what's wrong with this person? No, we're going to say, oh man, I've been there. I've been there. And let's pray that God would establish he who we are to put our hope in. Hope is to be in the person of Jesus Christ. So here's my singular application question. Do you believe that he will not fail you? I think it's fair to say, I don't know. I don't know. And that's okay. Because if we live long enough, we'll have that answer. And that answer is very, very clear for those who have long lives. And that is that he does not fail. He cannot fail. He will not fail. And friend, he will not fail you. He will not fail you. It's not in his nature. So the way I want to pray for us, Daniel, why don't you come on up? The way I want to pray for us is that we would believe what is true. That we would believe what's true. Some of us are exhausted. Oh man, if there's anything that is clear of this season, the season of like the end of the year and all the things, I mean, people are so exhausted, just burnt to a crisp. I mean, it's like people are sliding into Christmas Day. It's crazy. It's like just smoking, just sliding. And they just like, as soon as they stop sliding, it's like, January 25th, let's rejoice. It's like, man, that looks terrible. No, for some of us, we need to rest in the fact that God is a God who says what he does and does what he says. And when he says you can trust him because of the resurrection, then may our heart believe that. And so that's how I want to pray for you. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Christ, would you help us believe in hope, a living hope? We don't hope upon nothing. We hope through the resurrection in Christ, because he will not fail. He will not fail. He will not fail you. If it weren't so weird, I would love to just say the names of each person here. Just start calling people out. Listen to me. You, specific person, he will not fail in this place in your life. To the person wondering about the future, he will not fail you. For the person who's enduring in their marriage, he will not fail you. To the person who wants so badly for their house to sell or house to buy, he will not fail you. To the person in pain, he will not fail you. To the person who's lost loved ones and is grieving that, he will not fail you. To the person who's grieving the loss of a spouse, he will not fail you. To the person in here who is just absolutely checked out, concussed, numb, he will not fail you. To the person who's exhausted and needs the kind of sleep that a nap won't fix, oh God, He will not fail you. To the person who just is unbelievably uncertain and fearful, He will not fail you. Thank God you're a God that doesn't fail His people. May we hope in that promise this Adventist season. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Church, as we get ready to take communion, if you want to grab your elements here, I'm going to read out of Luke 22. Jesus is sitting with His disciples at Passover, and He says in verse 15, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you I will not eat of it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God." And after taking the cup, He gave thanks, and He said, "Take this and divide it among you, for I tell you I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." It's just like Pastor Jason was telling us, Jesus, as a man, was hoping in what He knew was coming. And we get to experience that as believers. He then says, when He takes the bread, if you want to take the bread or the cracker, the wafer little thing, He says, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Take and eat. In the same way, after the supper, He took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Fellow Christians, let's take this and celebrate together. Thank you, Jesus, for your body. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Thank you that this act of remembering is not physical nourishment to our body, but it is spiritual nourishment to our souls. Thank you that the finished work on the cross, the death, burial, resurrection of our King. Thank you that we can remember on a weekly basis that what we are building and what we are seeking is not our own kingdoms, but your own, Father. Thank you that you will fulfill the purposes that you have for each of us as the body of Christ. We love you. May we sing these truths now as we finish out the service and this time of gathering as the body of Christ. We love you and we bless your name. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen.
We hope you've enjoyed today's message. For more information, visit our website at lighthousentx.com.